Mostly in life, we're looking at how do I make a life worth living and a retirement worth having. I probably mumble a little bit because it's been a long day, and I honestly just woke up from a nap in literally a great place that allows us to kind of sit down and be okay with just being out of breath and out of time and out of a lot of things. But in life, when we have moments of time, we have to know how to utilize those moments of time. And I'm literally walking in champagne. And when I say that, it means that when we don't have caviar days, we might have days of joy, of fulfillment, and of love and happiness, regardless of what's going on in our life. As many of you know, I've lost everything in cybercrime on my life. And I'm still losing practically all my household goods because some person out there somewhere thought that they'd back out 6 months of pay of what I provided them to protect my foreign invested goods and quality heirlooms and things from my late father in my own storage locker that I paid for a long time with the loving help of a relative, and decided to sell those things off to the local sheriff's department, which I find beyond utterly offensive. Not only is it wrong on a moral level that someone would believe that they have the right to take away a man's life goods, but it's wrong on a legal level because those people are not actually talking with me. They're allegedly talking to people who are allegedly related to me, of which there'd be no proof. Since I'm not actually living in that present place, it's very difficult for them to prove, not at all. The reality is that the actual legal contract is with me, so they don't really have the lawful right to talk to anyone besides me or my legal heir, which I actually placed on the back of the form that they provided me. Now, if that form goes disappearing, who's to say that they didn't let go of it because they were getting caught in the theft of my property and goods? Literally every time that I went into that unit, I found things moved about. Things as simple as a pair of boots that I could have literally used in this stormy winter time when my feet are get practically freezing in the cold months, but also my own clothing, my own traditional wares, my things from my loving life as a Japanese language teacher, and also from my business practice. I had a lot of intellectually minded books and religious objects that have been pilfered and stolen, and how does anyone prove it when people in your life think they have the right to manhandle or to promote themselves as somehow having rights over you, which they really don't have under any federal law? The truth is, when I talk about these things, the people listening will understand, but the people who are not fully up on our rights and our human rights with regard to our own personhood, paperwork, and property that I've often talked about in the political realm don't really get it. We have a lot of people who are violating our rights today. We have people who walk up and try and give a total stranger something that they don't want and they don't need. I had a man try to provide me a sweatshirt, which I would have never worn in my life, based on what was the character on it, but also on the fact that I didn't ask him for one thing. I was literally sitting waiting for some opportunity to produce for myself a little meal. Now, I'm a little bit slow of heart and a little bit short on breath, but openly, this is one of my last video casts for a while. I've got a lot to accomplish in my life and a lot to build upon in my life when I'm starting over at literally age 50. The love of my life is the one that I protect the most. What I mean by that is that the people that I love most are the people that I protect from the liars, the thieves, and the stalkers on my life that have continued to stalk me across to the place that I am, literally stealing things from me in the middle of the night, thinking they have rights to tag me like a puppy, and openly it's immoral and it's illogical and it's unlawful. But there's always a monster who does those things, and I literally spent a good amount of months in jail because of someone's lie on my life, and openly it was not a fun sentence. I literally can name every single person who harassed me during that time who thought that they had rights over mine because they literally were in the law enforcement sect and they believed that they had one right over mine that I literally didn't have the right to say no to, and that was the right over the possession of my body. I had several people in their nursing set refuse to provide me my life-giving provision of a medical healthcare product because of the lies that they told themselves of what they believed they had rights to do. The reality is that it's caused me to have a stroke now. It's also caused me to have major migraines because they thought they would just say no and deny me that right. There are several women that are facing, I believe, federal charges for violating my rights to medical rights and other aspects of my life, along with officers who might be facing all sorts of difficulties with regard to stalking and harassment of a man's life. But in life, we have moments of time to decide what kind of person are we going to be in front of God's house. And God's house is not what a man's opinion is. God's house is what God provides us. When I talk about personhood, when I talk about paperwork, when I talk about property, I'm really talking about what are our rights that are provisioned by the Lord above all things, above all people who have the right to say nothing about our lives. God is the one who solicits all aspects of our life from people. What's amazing, though, is how people play out of what God wants for their life. They pretend that God's not telling them to stop doing something. They pretend that God is telling them to harass, to harm, to subjugate, to mistreat, to malfeast, to manipulate, to molest, to do all sorts of things to people in the name of the Lord. Even today, when I went to a loving place to have a wonderful meal produced by people who are of a loving background and a loving God, according to some of the people who have actually shared their faith, literally thought that a man had the right to step in front of me in line. I had been waiting for several hours to be amongst the first to receive that loving meal, but openly, that's what it's like in the hood. When I talk about these things, I'm talking about real life. When we lose our rights, when we have people interfering with our lawful right to walk, to move, in our civil liberties, our mobilities, and other things that civil rights and other people fought for long ago, for all people of all practices, of all faiths, of all religions, we lose rights. And what I mean by rights are where your rights begin and literally your rights end. They begin and end only with your personhood, meaning your physical being belongs solely, singly to you and the Lord above who provided it to you. If you are finding yourself ill, you might want to look above to God to see what did you do to cause that illness within you, and have you prayed over your own life to be healthy and healthier, happier in your life. When I talk about personhood and paperwork, I'm really talking about our legal aspects of our life. The fact that even those law enforcement officers who held me in jail produced a fake document in my departure saying that I literally had brown hair and brown eyes, which is most people who know me well is absolutely untrue, not to mention what it mentions on my own driver's license, which openly is from a different place. But the reality is I don't have any hair, as you can see at the top of my head. My beard is a little bit of a goldenrod, that is true, but my eyes are clearly blue. The reality is that they do it as a joke, as a lark. They think it's funny. The clothing I received back from having spent most of my time in orange, what you would call medical robes, if you will, as a part of that incarceration time for allegedly not producing enough time in the life of other people demanded by an actual person who thought she had the right to lord over others and control their time and when they would respond and how quickly they could schedule people and all those sorts of things, literally are not my clothing. But when I received my clothing back from the law who was holding it, what I found was that most of my beautiful shirts that were singly found for me by the loving Lord above and placed in my care were ripped up the sides, especially my two most favorite shirts were literally ripped all the way up the sides. So I will have to find a seamstress to delicately take those silk shirts that I found as one of a kind and put them back together when I have the chance and when I have the money. It really makes me angry because they were productively promotional for my business and my practice that has openly that logo, that dragon, those things in the promotion of who I am and what my mentality is, and openly verses in the Bible that relate to my company name. But openly, when I continue to talk about these things, we're really talking about my paperwork, that someone thought they had the right to refuse to pay a bill on my behalf after it was negotiated for my life to it be paid, and that in effect produced a destruction of my actual bank accounts, which literally ruined some of my life opportunities and my rights to actually have a bank account with people who were violating my rights talking to other people about my banking in the first place. You see, we have a lot of younger generation that don't know where their rights begin and end. We have a lot of people who literally don't know what to say and what to do and how to be in this world. When I talk about these things, I'm talking about real life. We also have a lot of people who will simply say, I'm going to do this for you, which isn't their right to do. Their job is to simply say, how can I help you best? You see, when we spell out the word help, we are spelling out H-E-L-P. H is for hospitality and giving someone the grace that they need to extend into their life to see if we can actually serve them in some way. E is when we educate them on what it is we practically within the positions, the responsibilities, and the powers of our world of work we can do to lawfully serve whatever their personal goals are, their personal needs for the day or the week are. And then we have L. That can be turned into a lot of things. It can be turned into leadership. It can be turned into how we lead people once we understand where their goals are headed. It can be a part of liability. In other words, what are our legal liabilities to what we are providing them? If we're providing them food, when we have to be very clear about what is safe and what is not safe food, we also have to be very thoughtful about their allergies. And while I was practically incarcerated, they had my allergies wrong almost every single day. And I suffered physically on the cellular level from it. And openly, they kept providing me with chocolate, which is difficult for me. But when you want to eat and not starve to death, you have to eat what you're provided. That's just a humble example of how people can be incompetent in their work, because the reality was, since it wasn't their food, they didn't really give a damn. When we're talking about L, we're also talking about legacy, the legacy of our life. When we are called home by the Lord, whenever the Lord chooses, whatever you believe in as a higher power or higher being, we are going to be literally liable for what we did in front of God above, who's looking down from us from our positions in life to determine whether or not we did things in His way. In his way is always loving and kind. In our way is always selfish. It's striking other people. It's harming their life. It's putting them in legal plays that are not lawful. And openly, we might just find ourselves at the end of our life in horrendous illness that take away the powers of our abilities or loses our eyesight or literally makes us feeble and weak of mind around the people who allegedly love us because we did not do something correct in front of God's house. I know that a little bit because I had a fairly physically aggressive father in my youth, and he left his life in a very humbled state of not being able to totally control all his ADLs or adult daily living function capabilities, and he passed after a week literally of starving to death because at that point his illness was so great he could no longer eat. It was a humbling moment in time, which I've talked about several times, of my prayer of letting him be released to the Lord. And in that moment that I prayed for his life, he literally ascended into the Heavenly Father's house. And openly, my sister called in that moment to let me know he had been gone or he had left his physical being. And openly, I watched my sisters fuss all over his dead body. And I thought, wow, they sort of missed the point that he had already ascended, and making such a fuss over a dead physical space was sort of odd for me, but I let them do it because he was being honored for his military status, and I did really regard that a great deal. I met several military men who play like they are something special in my life, which they're not. And then when we get to the P, it's provision. It's the actual aspect of providing the specific help that an individual is asking for. If an individual is simply asking for a hamburger, then you only provide them that one hamburger. You don't ply them with 10 hamburgers that they literally can't eat and that someone will pull for in the middle of the night. I had a loving person at McDonald's who I probably got into trouble the first time she ignored me. One of the first times I passed through their town, literally give me like a bag of food. I would have been content with just a couple of the chicken nuggets she provided me, but she did do it in love in the name of her company and her brand, which I appreciated. But it was so much food and beef that I couldn't handle it in my physical system. But what's more, with the part that I saved in the freezing cold for my breakfast, some lying person thought they had the right to open while I was asleep, literally on a concrete slab, take out the food I had planned for breakfast and literally take it away from me, so I had nothing for breakfast the next day. Now, when we apply it to other people's lives, we have to understand that we have to decide, is this a short-term impact on our life, or is this a long-term impact, and how will we handle that when we're providing them something that they specifically need? Like in my case, I'm needing my boots, but openly they've probably been pilfered from my storage unit. I also need some other books in order to produce the life that I planned for myself now that I've post-loss of a significant other, and my son has already moved off into his life, into my grandchildren allegedly. But openly, people don't always want to recognize the fact that I lived for a long time producing my life without any of their help ever. But in reality, what we're talking about that is that specific provision of assistance. When a person asks for one thing, we don't go above and beyond that. We don't take away their rights. We don't ping them like a dog so that we know where they are at all times, and we most certainly don't stalk them. Stalking, of course, as we all know, is a federal offense, and that is illegal, not to mention immoral. And there are people who do that, and it's one of the reasons that I left, to make sure that my loving family is completely safe from the immoral and illegal, illicit people who have been harming my life, but also to produce the fact that the one that I love more than life itself, the one that the Lord has provided for me many, many signs, is she is the love of my life based on who she is in her heart, her mind, her soul, most importantly, to my life and the impact she made on me spiritually, religiously, and all those things that she did for me in those brief moments of time that we openly were very active and very professional and very explicit friends. And I just mean in the fact that we talked about everything, literally, from life to death, that openly that is the one that I love and that is the one that I will protect with my life. By moving away from that community, I have the right to protect that individual from harm along with her children. And there's always someone who lies to themselves and thinks that they have the right to go into other places ahead of a person because they have the actual vehicle to get there ahead of them or to predict where they go or to literally promise something to other people that they don't have the right to do. I have lived in a shelter for a little while to produce myself some safety and warmth and met some very loving men who share food, some who have disabilities, some who have some mental challenges, but for the most part, people are loving and kind. But there's always that one monster, that one moron, that one imbecile who thinks that while a man is sleeping, they have the right to open a person's pack that they're traveling with, and in my case, it's just a few blankets, literally in a pair of underpants, but openly and monkey around with the papers, with the documents, with the business cards of people of whom I've just procured an interest in to try to tell me to do something with my life. The reality is they have no rights to my life. They have no rights to your life. And when we're talking about the provision of help, we're talking about a very specific response to a very specific need. And if that's all you can do for that person, that one moment of time, then you've produced one positive moment in time in terms of a homeless person or an impoverished person or even a person of influence or affluence's life. And when I talk about these things, I'm talking about real life, real living. Because if we get hit with cybercrime, if we get hit with the liars of the land, we can lose literally everything. And in my case, everything that I have in my own storage unit literally belongs to the woman I love if something should happen to me or if she so chooses to walk into that establishment and demand that they prove that they did not violently attack my life, steal property from me, and openly dissolve my rights to my legal contract based on some whim that they thought they'd put in their mind or some imbecile's idea that they have the right to take away all the private provisions of my life that the Lord above provided me. Every stitch of clothing that I have today came about from my own use of my own funds. Every provision, every aspect of my Japanese heritage that I produced from my own life came from the Lord's experience of allowing me to investigate that part of the world, that part of the land, and my own capabilities in that foreign language produced for me a life for a long time. In a very short period of time during the week, unlike other people who work 40 to 60 hours a week, I literally didn't have to work that long because I chose my life to spend my life loving on a family that was mine, having Fridays being a family day and openly making sure I was ever present for not only my loving spouse, but also for the provision of my son, who my understanding has gone into great little things in his own little company abroad a world away, someone that I don't even see. But you know what the monsters of the land did? They thought they would delete my son's phone number out of my phone system so that I don't even have the right to call my own son to find out how he's doing in his life at this late stage of his 30s. And that makes me ill, that there are monsters of this world who think they have the right to interfere not only in my life, but in the life of the people that I love. It's productively why I've stepped away from the communities in which I was residing in and discovered a new place that I love a great deal. I find the people very loving and kind. I find most of them caring. But the ones that keep interfering with my civil liberties and keep interfering with my lawful rights are going to be facing federal charges. And that's something I've made a promise on. But I will protect the ones I love all the time, every day, as my late father, who was a military man, a lieutenant colonel in the Air Force, taught me to do. I will not provide them any information of my siblings. I will not provide them anything about the woman that I love or her beautiful children, because that's what a man does. He protects who he loves until the very end. And openly, I'm beyond ready to handle my life. I don't need anyone in my life telling me who I am, what I can do, what I'm capable of. All I need is the freedom that we're allowed underneath the U.S. Constitution and other local laws and state laws to do what I need to do for my life. And as long as I'm not accosted, as long as I'm not stalked, as long as I'm not stolen from in the things that I set aside, like a simple bus schedule or a Greyhound schedule or things like that, because of my plan for my scheduling of my life, then I'll be able to accomplish my goals. But when people feel that they have the right to harass, to stalk, to harm, to give away inappropriately gossip information that's not theirs to give away at any shape or form, then we have a real problem in the land. When I talk like this, I'm talking about a real fact that people often bring about a social conversation. They share information in the concept of love and getting to know each other, but then they gossip like little schoolgirls. And I hate to call it like that, but I remember the teenage years and how horrible they can be. But the reality is that they gossip and give away information that's not lawfully theirs. We also have a lot of gaming community that literally want to take their little mysterious games that they play on board games and D&D and things like that and turn it about and put it on a person's human life. And they think they're having a gay old time doing that. And that might be the two men that I've proceeded to literally set apart in my community where I am now and figure out who they are by literally drawing them out and getting them out in the middle of nowhere at 2 or 3 in the morning to determine that they're likely law enforcement or there's someone as a part of the stalking community who've been harassing and harming my life. But again, back to the truth. The truth is that I am smart enough and I am thankfully in God's house enough to know what to produce in my life, for my life, and at the calling that the Lord has of me. And I will continue to pursue His love and all the things that the Lord Jesus in the world provides for me, but I will never claim again to be a Christian, because what I have found is that this concept of we will all know who are Christians by their love is not really true. People want to lie about that capability. They want to do all sorts of things, and the beginning of those situations that are ugly in the world starts with the lie. The lie of who you are, of what you do, is not the truth. The lie of what you think your little rights are to someone else's life is where that lie begins. That you believe that you have rights to someone other person's personhood, paperwork, property, or for that matter, their professions, is a lie you tell yourself. The only person you have control over in your life is you. You have no right to monitor, no right to manipulate, no right to molest, no right to accost, no right to stalk, no right to take things that a person throws away in the trash can and put it back in their belongings like a mischievous child. And openly, the minute I find out who did that on a regular basis to me over the last now 3 to 4 years, they will be regretting it. Because it won't be me who takes it out on them. It will be the law enforcement officers that do their jobs correctly, but also the people who police the police will handle it as well. Those people have lovingly provided me new shoes when I was freezing to death and openly provided me other aspects of life. But the monkey business that people produce of trying to pretend that they're not in law enforcement and they really are and trying to produce a lie on someone's life, those people will be taken out by God, and it will not be participating in that sort of thing. What I am doing is literally providing the woman that I love a safe place, that she has full rights to every aspect of my life is somewhat true because I can bequeath it so. That is my right under federal law to bequeath my life insurance policies on my own life to the woman that I love should something occur to me or should the Lord call me home. But at the same time, I have the right to bequeath every piece of my stitch of my clothing, my property, and anything in that storage unit that I'm literally having a loving patronal person in my relative set pay for is not for that patron just because they've offered up a small amount of cash does not give them the right to literally talk to that company at all. Their name is not on my legal contract. They don't have the right to talk to it. And the women and men in that management company that are violating federal law, talking to anyone allegedly claiming to be my family, have no way to prove those people are my family. The idea that they should back out 6 months of payments to produce a problem or a sale by the sheriff of my property is not only immoral under God's house and under his love, in the fact that he provides for all of our lives. He's the one who makes a plan for our lives, and if we listen carefully to that quiet voice, the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit that we're always talking about in these churches and these Christian synagogues and these or other oriented places like Buddhist temples, etc., that we literally produce a life. It's not that we stop listening that those things start to go missing or start to be pilfered from our lives. It's that other people immorally think and believe that they have rights to bequeath those to someone else, take them out, or play God as if they would have the right to edit the personal belongings of a fully functioning adult, or lie about how someone is functioning to produce their desire of control in someone's life. That is a mental illness, and we need to look at that very carefully in this world. That we also have people who monstrously steal not only property, but once they go beyond property, they start to think they have the right to steal a life. I've seen a lot of Asians, a lot of foreigners, a lot of Mexicans who barely speak our language, and yet they're somehow fully functioning here with the land of USA behind them. I don't think so. I think what they've probably produced is the ability to lie about who they are, take over someone's life, and God forbid knows what happened to those people. But openly, they might have just stolen their identities in a cybercrime situation and thought they had the right to produce themselves a life off that lie. You see, this is the land of America, where we are home of the brave and land of the free. And openly, I've got a runny nose because I've not been able to take my all-natural product that is produced by an amazing scientist who won the Elliott Crescent Medal, which is along the lines of Madame Curie, that caused my nose to actually cease in its dripping. But once I'm back to life, I will continue to do that. But openly, hopefully, my family who's participating in that program will still benefit from the fact that I still talk about those things in honor of the lineage of my father, who said this is a good quality thing and we need to do this for our own health care. You see, in life, we have moments of time to decide who we are, what we do, and how we will do it. And when I produce this video as the last video that I'm going to launch into this particular channel, it's not morally about magic. It's not really about the mayhem people cause. But here's what I've discovered, that people can either produce magic for other people or they can produce mayhem for people. Those who produce mayhem are literally facing a life in hell. Those who produce magic for others by loving on them and practicing that help concept I discussed of hospitality, education in terms of the boundaries of what they are and are not capable of, and the roles and responsibilities of an actual lawfully paid for position, as well as the leadership of legacy of how you want to be remembered by that individual, whether you were seen as loving and kind or whether you were seen as a monster, and then the provision of the actual specific help that that individual was requesting for the day, for the week, for the month, for the annum is what's most important. In life, there's only one person I love. I have not been unfaithful to that love since the loss of my loving long-term partner from a foreign land, but openly, I know that the Lord has chosen for my life, and I will profess that love until the day that I die, because that is my lawful right to choose who I love, when I love, and how I will love, and when the Lord decides to teach her that lesson she deserves to learn, that is up to him. But in those moments of time, I remain forever faithful, a loving priest, if you will, who has not literally touched another human being in an intimate way since the loss of my life partner. That's probably TMI for people, but you know what? The only way we produce loving, honorable men in this world is to recognize those that are the loving, honorable men. and to recognize the good people. The other day I was flying in line for a free sport coat since I've lost all my suits and I've lost so much weight that I literally am less than a 34 waist, just in case my mother's listening. But openly, I have several pairs of pants on underneath that 34 waist, and the Lord led me to an amazing spot. You see, it's not the magic in me that I experience, it's the magic of God that led me to a place that actually got me a pair of pants of all things precisely the size I need for this right moment in time. And what I mean by that is that I'm sort of short in the legs, and the Lord provided me the exact extension of that that I need. You see, when you listen to God, you get led to the right places. When you don't listen to God, when you listen to your own immoral egos, you lose out on all the things that the Lord has planned for your life. Every moment of happiness, every moment of joy, every moment becomes more limited when you choose to illegally, immorally harass someone's life because you think you've got lawful rights to do it. And the truth is you don't. The only life you have to produce for yourself is that one of you, a loving partner, and possibly some children until the time that they produce an adulthood. And then at that point, we step away and we send them off in love and pray that they've become the proper man or woman that we have chosen to support them in becoming based on the soul that the Lord has provided them in their physical being. Whether that physical being has a physical ailment, a mental ailment, a spiritual reckoning, that's really up to God's provision of lessons in life. But when I'm talking about walking in champagne, I mean that every day can be a joy, even when you're in the most humbling of situations like me, where I literally live in my clothes, I carry a bag with blankets, and pretty much a roll of toilet paper in my pocket, because the other day the Lord said, you're going to need this, and he was absolutely true. I got stranded in a moment of time of illness in my bowels, and thank God I had listened to God saying, take some toilet paper with you, because I really needed it, and otherwise it would have been a bloody mess. And I'm just making joke of the fact that even the simplest of things that we get an inkling on doing for our own loving of ourselves is truly a gift from the Lord. So when you think I'm sort of mentally unwell, go screw yourself. When you think that you have rights to make comment, that might be something you want to think about in terms of your rights to my life. I don't produce anything on my life that I won't literally say to someone else. And I've had to school a few young men today about where their rights begin and end. They're always trying to help people, which is a loving and kind thing. But when they're socially inept, it produces across cultures, across ethnic groups, a difficulty that could get them literally pounded down by the people who are of lesser quality, is not the point, by men who don't know where their boundaries begin and end. And I've seen fisticuffs break down over the simplest things, over standing in line. But I've also had people cut in line and do all sorts of immoral and childish things, trying to produce a power play in someone's life, and that in itself is a lie they tell themselves. They are physically going to go to hell when they particularly pass into the spirit life, when the Lord calls them home, and the Lord can do that at any time. For anyone like me who's literally lost their life in that way and returned, we know what that literally is like. We know what's love and we know what's challenge. But in life, we have moments of time to tell people how we feel, to discuss who we are, to share a part of our life. But we don't have the right, once we produce that level of trust, to literally take that information and share it out across the masses if we didn't have the right to protect our opportunity to become really well associated, really well entangled, really well open to the fact that God put those people on our path for life lessons, for loving lessons, for kindness, for care, for communication, for friendship, for fellowship, for faithfulness, for whatever the Lord has chosen. In these words, I let you go and say, Mom, I love you a lot, I miss you a lot, and I wish that I could tell you about my life. But to keep you safe, to keep my loving siblings, who are morons most of the time, safe, and to keep the woman that I love more than life itself safe, I will continue my life until the time that the people who are doing this preposterous thing in my life stop. And either God will stop them soon, or the right people will. Thanks for listening. In Jesus' name, we go.